Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Greenville 2014. Gentlemen, please welcome to the stage the Honorable Mitchell J. Landrieu, Mayor of New Orleans.
How y'all doing? That's really good. Let's try that again, New Orleans style. How y'all doing? All right, we're going to set a couple of ground rules before we begin. It's not New Orleans. It's New Orleans. All right, that's very good. All right, let's try this. Laissez, les, bon temps, roulez. All right, laissez les bon temps roulez. All right, that's pretty good. Y'all practice that. That just means have a good time while y'all are here. Figuratively, let your head down. I know it's hard to do for some of us, but just kind of, y'all got to get that going on. All right, Greenville, welcome to New Orleans. I'm pumped up that you're here. 5 years ago, you guys made a commitment to the city to come back here, and y'all are honoring that commitment tonight. You guys are 26,000 strong. I'm pumped up about that. Give yourself a round of applause. So, I'm the mayor of this great city. I happen to think it's the greatest city in the world. I'm right about that. I know y'all come from nice places, but you didn't come from New Orleans. All right, so let's talk about where we are. I want you guys to look up. This is the building where a lot of our citizens were stranded when the biggest man-made disaster that hit the United States coursed through this particular piece of the world and hopefully made you stop in your tracks and gasp at the possibility that we could lose a great American city. I was a lieutenant governor at the time. At 2 o'clock in the morning, one of my friends that was running this building, that was taking care of all the people, was on the phone with me when I was in the Emergency Operations Center in Baton Rouge, and he said, Mitch, the roof is peeling off of the building. We have thousands and thousands of people in it. We don't know if we're going to make it. This building, which was the scene of one of the greatest catastrophes, a short time thereafter, right, has become the symbol of resurrection and redemption for the city of New Orleans and, in many instances, the United States of America. We had a situation here that should have never happened and that should never happen again. We weren't ready. The country wasn't ready. And guess what? It wasn't the first time and it's not the last time we're going to have a major event that threatens the lives of so many people. 500,000 homes got hurt. 250,000 got destroyed. 1,800 lives were lost in a city that represented the soul of America in all of its richness, the strength of its diversity, its culture, its music, its place in the world of economic development, being the place where we have four of the largest ports in the world, which are right down the river from us, a place that imports and exports most of the goods that come in and out of this country, that provides a lot of the oil and gas and energy for this country, a place that provides most of the seafood, almost went away overnight. Because we as a nation never really thought about what resilience means and how we build back strong and build back smart and build for the future rather than the past. But in the last 9 years, the people of the city of New Orleans have done something spectacular with your help, and we thank you for all of it. We decided not to build back the city that we were. We recognize that Katrina and Rita did not cause all of our problems, that on August 28th, the night before the storm, we had a lot of years of built up bad decisions that created bad schools, infrastructure that was crumbling, school systems that did not teach our children, economic development that didn't work, and a government that didn't work for the people. And we decided as a people, black and white, rich and poor, Lakeview, Lower Ninth Ward, Gertown, Backertown, Pension Town, every place, that we were going to build the city that we always should have been. And now, 9 years later, you see a school system that's been completely reconstructed, functionally, programmatically, and building-wise, so that we've built buildings for the future and put our kids in 21st century schools. You see a healthcare delivery system that's not just patient, that's not just centered around a university hospital, but has 88 primary healthcare clinics feeding people into primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary care. You see an economy that grew in Louisiana, our sales tax 9.6% last year. The national average was 1.2%. You see people that have decided to come back together and actually do something that nobody else has come back and said, listen, not only no, but hell no, come hella high water, we're going to stay where we are, and we're going to be smart about how we build for the future and start preparing ourselves for bigger storms, badder storms, stronger storms, sea levels that are rising, and understanding that you can't live against the environment, you can't live an opposite to water, you have to live with it. And so as we continue to rebuild the city of New Orleans, thank you very much, and as we continue to rebuild the city of New Orleans, we here think that we have become this nation's most immediate laboratory for innovation and change. Whether we're talking about education, healthcare, resilience, building back green, we want to become a symbol for what America always should be, because, ladies and gentlemen, we were the canary in the coal mine. Now, I had to explain this to my 23-year-old because she didn't understand what a canary in the coal mine was. So all of you people that are older than me, understand that when you're talking to the younger generation. When it happened to us, you may remember some pejorative comments being made by people like the Speaker of the House, who said those people are dumb, they ought to just move out of there. And he forgot to realize that 85% of the people in America are living by water, that the city of New Orleans really isn't the place that most at risk. When we did a risk analysis, some of the folks in Florida around Miami, and then some of the folks kind of on the northeastern corridor that unfortunately we found out about that got hurt by Sandy, and that other places are susceptible to bad things that are going to happen. And this could be a terrorist attack, it could be an earthquake, it could be a public health threat, it could be water, it could be electricity, whatever that might be. We in this country have to do a better job of living smarter and living stronger and living for the future. And that's what we in New Orleans are trying to do. And after 9 years of struggle, we feel like that we're heading in the right direction. We happen to be now the fastest growing city in America. We happen to be a city that the Wall Street Journal says is one of the best places to do business. Now, let me say this and I'm gonna get out of your way. That doesn't mean that we don't have our challenges. But let me tell you what it does mean. We're just like you, and you're just like us. And even though we dance a little bit different, we might look a little bit different, we eat a little bit different food, right? We celebrate life and death maybe a little bit different, we're all Americans. And the things that happened in New Orleans were instructive about things that should happen all across America. So please do me a favor. Learn from what we've done. Learn from our strength. Learn from our weaknesses. And think about the ways that America could be strong together, thinking about the future, not the past. I love all of you guys. Thank you so much for coming. I hope you have a great time and be safe. Yeah, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the U.S. Green Building Council's CEO and founding chairman, Rick Fedrizzi.
Hello, Greenbelt. My speech starts out, I got two words for you, but I think they are now Ivan Neville. Hello, Ivan Neville. Wow. I got two other words for you today. New Orleans. Pretty amazing, isn't it? It was almost a decade ago, and all bets were off as to whether or not this place would still be standing. The wind raged, the waters rose, the levees broke, and a city, a people, and some might say even an entire way of life changed forever. It was 2005, and that year, if you remember, we had Greenbelt in Atlanta about 60 days after Katrina hit. And there we assembled the best and the brightest from across our movement. Some from the Gulf Coast who were already emotionally stunned by what they experienced. Many of you sitting here tonight analyzed and prioritized a strategy that would become known as the New Orleans Principles. Principles that could and would serve as a roadmap for rebuilding this decimated city. And there in Atlanta, we made a promise that we would stand with New Orleans as it began the hard work of rebuilding, and that we'd bring Greenbuild there as soon as they were ready. We'd bring our $30 million in economic impact, our appreciation for history and architectural heritage, and our knowledge, energy, and passion. And we would convene here in New Orleans a Greenbuild like no other. And here we are. Yes. Because of you, the remarkable, amazing people who make up our movement, the visionaries, the collaborators, the data geeks, and the doers, and last but never least, the troublemakers, the leaders who refuse to let anything stand in their way. Because of you, we are building, and in this case, rebuilding a more sustainable future. And if you want to know what that future looks like, you don't really have to go much further than right here in the Lower Ninth Ward, where Make It Right's Tom Darden III, Brad Pitt, and Bill McDonough showed us how to do it right, with 100 LEED Platinum certified homes and counting, and a community reborn. Yes. Also here in New Orleans, dedicated professionals from USGBC, the Clinton Climate Initiative, Global Green, and the U.S. Department of Energy worked hand in hand with a recovery school district to give their leadership and staff the personnel and technical support needed and help them achieve a goal of LEED Silver certification for every single school in this city. USGBC's very own Anissa Baldwin-Metzger lived here for 2 years and worked with district offices, resulting in 7 certified schools already and 27 additional currently pursuing certification. Thank you all for helping us get to this amazing place today. New Orleans, the Big Easy. Here we are in the heart of the Mississippi Delta, where the most storied river in America takes a final deep breath before heading into the Gulf. Some call it Big Muddy, but you know when the Mississippi begins to rise and take shape just this side of Canada, it's neither big nor muddy. It's rather the barest trace of a little creek. And as it begins to wind its way south, it starts gathering things a little here and a little there. And the next thing you know, that little trickle in Minnesota becomes the mighty Mississippi, a river that's as much a mindset as a marvel of nature. And on the crest of those waters flowing north to south, jazz was born. A little attitude and a little rhythm from Chicago, a touch of melody from St. Louis, some boldness and brassiness from Memphis, and a big dollop of deep south melting pot gumbo from right here in the Delta. And eventually, it all coalesced into something wonderful, joyous, and truly American. Thank you, Mr. Armstrong. The great Louis Armstrong, ladies and gentlemen. And that music is a metaphor too, right? A metaphor for leadership, which is why we chose Leadership Jazz, that great book by Max Dupree, grandson of the founder of Herman Miller, as the theme for this year's Greenbuild. Max talks about how jazz combines the unpredictability of the future with the gifts of talented individuals who follow the vision of a true leader. It's a loose collaboration of intent depending on individuals with diverse talents Individuals who are willing to take risks, explore possibilities, to play off each other within a defined context. And when they succeed, it's unlike anything else. In the context of New Orleans, leadership jazz is how you take a city and make something truly wonderful by amassing the talents that exist on every street corner, finding the instrument that best suits them, and encouraging them to take risks and explore possibilities. And it's the leadership of that effort, from mayors to moms, that matter most of all. Last year, I stood on this stage, much like this one, and I asked everyone listening to join us, to join our movement and our mission and help make sustainability to an even broader audience. I made that invitation based on the premise that we can do far more together than we could ever do alone. Instead of pulling in 1,000 different directions, we all pull together in a single direction and with a single purpose. When we move all those little pup tents of ego and enterprise into one big tent of common purpose, we really can change the world. In fact, it's the only way we can solve the huge issues in front of us: climate change, resilience, human health, things that we thought only were possible with a top-down fix. Well, guess what? Our amazing collaborative effort is finally speaking with one voice so loudly that we're shaking the foundation of conventional wisdom, and now more than ever, delivering it from the bottom up. Our biggest signal that we're no longer waiting for that top-down pipe dream to occur happened just a couple of weeks ago when millions of people from 166 countries rallied in support of climate change policy. In New York, absolutely. And finally, in New York, more than 400,000 let loose with an unmistakable roar that shook the foundations of every political campaign, corporate board, and environmental NGO. The individual voices expressed at the rallies in New York, Delhi, London, and Amsterdam, and other cities were passionate. And the signs they were carrying, they were strong in tone, a little bit wacky, and some were actually wrong. But what was heard around the world was one voice, one clear message that we can no longer wait and that we have to act now. At this time, when the world actually seems to be having a nervous breakdown of its own, when in the face of terrorism, inequality, Ebola, and global instability, fatalism and pessimism seem to be the currencies of the day. We, our movement, spoke up with a single voice of determination and optimism, so powerfully resonant that finally, and maybe only for a few moments, the world really stopped to listen. And they heard from mayors who are working to expand public transportation and working with pipeline companies to move people off dirty fuel oil and onto cleaner natural gas. They heard from governors who are actually introducing cap and trade at the state level and opening green banks to get it done. And those signs at the climate march that I mentioned earlier, the ones that I said were wrong, well, those were the ones that wanted to ban capitalism altogether. At a time when we need the innovation and resources of business and industry more than ever. When Charles Darwin wrote his world-changing book on the origin of species, he provided a simple, mind-bending explanation for the astounding complexity of life on Earth. Nature selects and reproduces the traits best suited for a species' survival. Some adapt to their surroundings and thrive. Others fail to adapt and die. Adaption isn't a conscious process, of course. Fish don't decide to grow legs or lungs, and chimps don't decide to grow bigger brains. Natural selection is the result of many forces, from climatic and environmental changes to hungry predators to random genetic mutations that every now and again luckily result in an evolutionary leg up for the next generation. Survival of the fittest has long been applied to the world of business, but few people fully appreciate the incredible implications of this idea in today's rapidly changing economic ecosystem. Our next speaker, Paul Hawken, told us this would happen more than 20 years ago. Businesses would choose to adapt a new economic environment shaped by climate change and more than a century of industrial pollution. That increased energy cost would force business to become radically efficient. That resource scarcity and rising commodity prices would force companies to reduce waste and alter their supply chains. And all because of the dawning recognition that environmental degradation would become a measurable drag on corporate profits and economic growth. And that public opinion and consumer preferences would force industry to develop greener, safer, more cost-effective products. In this new economic ecosystem, survival of the fittest means survival of the greenest. Our genetic code of business is undergoing a dramatic evolution from a single strand of profit to the double helix of profit and planet. Now, there's no question that our evolution to a sustainable economy is underway by making sustainability decisions in part of their strategic imperative. Food companies are changing the way they buy commodities in ways that also reduce deforestation. The big banks, beginning to invest big dollars in renewable energy and health-related resources and funding that investment through green bonds. In the chemical industry, yes, those very same folks that we were crossing swords with just a year ago have been welcomed to our table. And in the spirit of open collaboration, both organizations understand that we can leverage each other's strengths and expertise to drive innovation and growth without ever losing sight of how all humans are impacted by our work. Thank you. Our green building movement, ladies and gentlemen, has been a grassroots movement from the beginning and pure jazz from the inside out. It was founded on the promise of a rating system built by diverse talents who raised their hands as volunteers and went to work creating LEED. It gathered steam at the first Green Build in Austin, a leadership jazz fest if I ever saw one, and it's been carefully nurtured in every chapter and influenced by every one of our 200,000 plus LEED professionals. Just like this big river behind us, we continue to gather strength, depth, and richness with every mile we travel. And we've learned a lot on this journey. We've learned we need new, creative, transformative tools like the LEED Dynamic Plaque, which is an absolute existing building game changer. Think of it as a Fitbit for a building that measures real-time performance in energy, water, waste, transportation, and human experience. With now thousands of orders for these from all over the world, the dynamic plaque is clearly that missing piece that the market has been waiting for. We also learned that aggregating data and reporting tools like GRESB, which tracks sustainability metrics across entire real estate portfolios, and GBIG, which simplifies rich and often complex data on the building level, are market accelerants of the first order. We've learned that where our kids learn really does matter as much as what we teach them. So we know that we've created a whole new kind of modern jazz at the Center for Green Schools and its ever-expanding global work. And we've learned that our buildings and communities are the nexus for everything we want and need to do to improve human health. And we learned that through our buildings, we can speak for those who often don't have a voice. So it gives me tremendous pleasure to announce today that after several years of hard work, we have added 3 new credits on social equity to the LEED Pilot Credit Library. These credits make a strong statement by USGBC that the organization is committed to social equity principles, and our intent is to use the power of LEED to advance them. It's a long overdue start, folks, but a critically important one. And I have many thanks and congratulations to the dedicated volunteers and staff on the Social Equity Working Group who made this possible. And I'd also like to make, yes, to all of them, I'd also like to make a personal shout out to Kimberly Lewis, my friend and colleague, whose heart is bigger than this Superdome, and who daily reminds us to whom much is given, much is expected, and that our responsibilities are to better humanity and give a hand up to others in the process. Kimberly, please stand for this audience. She is really that awesome. Our green building movement is a wellspring that feeds this larger movement, because the better our buildings perform, the more they're the first best defense against climate change. As their improved energy efficiency reduces carbon emissions, we are making progress. As we reduce whole building energy use and the embodied energy in every building product, we are making progress. As we reconfigure how we interface with a smart grid that's becoming more and more electron agnostic about its fuel sources, we are making progress. Here at the 21-year mark, it's clear that we've hit our stride and found our voice, and we're making sure that every corridor of power is repeatedly exposed to our vision of what's possible. That's what we need now more than ever, folks. Hands-on, face-to-face contact with people all over the world. And not just from the political left that I know most of you and I are all comfortable with, but the people representing the width, breadth, and depth of the full political spectrum. Through repeated exposure, they're going to find something that resonates. They're going to see LEED in other like-minded, authentic rating systems like PEER and WELL, Living Building Challenge, and a host of intelligent and connected building rating systems from around the globe, all working from a place of agreement instead of armed camps of division. The choice is up to all of us at every level of leadership, every sector of society, and every corner of the world. So let's use this time, let's use this place, and let's use the force of our movement to choose active engagement, not passive-aggressive paralysis. Let's choose leadership, collective, corrupt, collective, disruptive. We'll leave the corruptive outside. Bold, creative leadership to set our course. Let me leave you with this final thought. The problems we face may be mind-numbing, but the opportunities in front of us are exhilarating. We can take full advantage and solve them if we approach them together with open minds, generous hearts, and an abiding faith in the rightness of our actions. Let's take heart in the fact that our commonalities are far greater than our factions. All we need is one voice, folks, a voice that shatters the foundation of conventional thinking. That voice comes from one movement in the jubilant celebration of what's possible. We've only got one chance to get it right, so for the sake of our future, folks, let's get it right. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Paul Hawken, founder of Project Drawdown.
So how do you follow Ivan Neville and Rick Fedrizzi? Tonight we're going to have a conversation with two distinguished gentlemen, Governor Martin O'Malley of Maryland and Tom Steyer of San Francisco and California. I invited these two men for several reasons. Foremost, they're both extraordinarily literate and active in their respective professions with respect to climate change. And second, they are truly the best at what they do. Governor O'Malley has been called the best manager in government by the Washington Monthly, and Tom Steyer may very well be the best politician in business. Governor O'Malley came to office inheriting a huge structural deficit In 7 years, he cut state spending by a record amount, had the lowest year-to-year budget increases of any governor during his terms. He lowered income tax for 86% of Marylanders, cut $9.5 billion in state expenditures, and completely reformed the way state government is operated and run through a data-driven management system he pioneered. He raised minimum wages to $10.10 and was one of only 7 states to maintain his AAA bond rating during the last recession. A politician who can manage finance. Who knew? Tom Steyer knows how to manage, too. He turned an initial $8 million in seed capital into the $20 billion hedge fund Fairlawn Capital Management. Fairlawn practiced and pioneered the term called absolute return, growing at an average of 15% a year, whether markets were up or down. In 2010, Tom and his wife Kat joined Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, and 37 other billionaires in pledging to give at least half of their fortunes to worthy causes. He chaired and supported Prop 39 in California, closing a long-time tax loophole for oil companies that is and will bring $1 billion a year in additional tax revenues for the state and for clean energy projects. O'Malley invested heavily in education and was named the number one by the College Board in holding down the cost of college tuition. Maryland schools have been voted the best public schools in the nation the last 5 years running. Yeah, Maryland. Maryland was named number one in innovation in entrepreneurship by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, normally not a big supporter of Democrats. Tom and Kat have also invested heavily in education, giving $40 million to create the Tomcat Center for Sustainable Energy at Stanford University. They created Beneficial State Bank, a community-owned bank and a foundation where all the profits of the bank go back to the community, Oakland, California in this case. And to start it off, they made a $26 million deposit, which then they gave to the foundation. And they also created the Steyer Taylor Center for Energy Policy and Finance at Stanford. Governor O'Malley served 2 terms as chair of the Democratic Governors Association. He was appointed to the nation's first ever Council of Governors by President Obama in 2010 and was named co-chair of the council in 2013. And Maryland was the first state to join REGI, the New England Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. Tom Steyer has cut a recent and wide swath in climate politics. He launched Next Gen Climate Change, a super PAC estimated to spend $80 to $100 million in this election cycle, targeting climate deniers and candidates who are basically shills for the oil, coal, and gas industry. But they have other similarities. Both are deeply religious. Both go to church every Sunday. Martin is up at 5 a.m. in the morning reading Thomas Berry and other spiritual texts. Tom writes crosses on his hand every morning with a blue ballpoint pen, and his idea of luxury is camping out with Kat in the mountains. And both are a lot of fun. Governor O'Malley has his own band, O'Malley's March. Go to YouTube if you love Irish music. And Tom may be one of the happiest people you'll ever meet. And there's one other similarity. They both met their wives in college, both of whom are named Catherine, both of whom were studying law when they met them, and they both met them in 1986. Please join me in welcoming Tom Steyer and Governor Martin O'Malley. Okay. So I've started with a few questions, and then we'll see where it goes. The main thing tonight is to have fun with you guys. You've been having fun. But I want to start with you, Governor. In June 2013, the Washington Monthly, as I mentioned, wrote this article entitled, "Should Martin O'Malley Be President?" And I want to quote it. It said, "What makes O'Malley stand out is not his experience, not his gravitas, not his familiarity to voters, nor is exactly his policies or speeches, nor is it that he plays in a band, nor is it even the Atlantic Monthly's breathless claim last year that he has the best abs in politics. Instead, what makes O'Malley unique as a politician is he is arguably the best manager working in government today. So, if you were president, how would you approach climate change in ways that have not been tried or imagined? What would you do if you knew you couldn't fail?"
Well, Paul, I mean, one of the things that I've learned in leading and managing other people and working with people and being in the center of, you know, the meaningful collaborations, the schools and the other things you mentioned, is that expectations become behavior. And so if there were one thing that I could do and I knew I couldn't fail, it would be to instill an awareness in our people, a belief, if you will, that climate change is not so much an inconvenient truth as it is a reality to be embraced that can lead us to a more secure and prosperous future. And that's really, I think, at the beginning point, if you will, and what makes other things possible. All of the things that you talk about in drawdown, developing new and needed skills in our people to make this transformation and to create jobs, a smart and renewable energy grid. All of these things that lead to that more prosperous future really depend upon our ability as a people to embrace this reality as a defining moment, a clarifying moment, a moment that opens up possibilities rather than something to be dreaded or seen as just this annoying or nagging inconvenience. And that's what I'd do if I knew I could not fail.
You couldn't fail. Okay, so Tom, you were quoted in The New Yorker saying you would accept the job of Secretary of Energy, right? I know you deny it now, but that's okay, you said that. So let me ask you the same question. If you were elected or appointed to higher office, and you could choose any office, by the way, you want, it's okay. What would you do if you could not fail?
Well, I would go along with what Martin said, and let me put a slightly different way of describing it. Because when you think about government and you think about leadership in a democracy, you can think about the kind of inside job of specific policies, and I think the administration is actually pursuing this very rigorously right now and trying to do everything they can without legislation to push a progressive climate policy. But what Martin was really talking about was what I think of as kind of the outside job, which is the education and the democratic process of going out to the American people and explaining actually the huge opportunity we have in front of us. And I see this as a generational challenge, which is also our generational opportunity for us to succeed. And I think that going out and making Americans aware that not just that we have to do it, but that we can do it. And when we do it, and I look at this conference as a prime example of what Americans can do when they're challenged and what they can innovate and how proud they can be of themselves at the success that they accomplish together, that I think for me personally, that would be a great pleasure. And I also believe, along with Martin, that getting our country to understand what we're the opportunity we have together to succeed is, you know, going to be the measure of how we're judged by ourselves and by our kids and by the world. And so I think that would be a fantastic opportunity to be part of that group of Americans facing up to our generational challenge.
Governor O'Malley, I know you, and I know the literacy you have with respect to the science on climate change. But then as governor, dealing with an elected legislature, dealing with, you know, obviously your constituents, I mean, you run into resistance and pushback and ignorance, frankly, as well as fear. I mean, what do you want to do? What do you think you can do? I mean, you have the bully pulpit now as governor. What is it that you can do that can break through that resistance?
Well, I'm very grateful to have served the people I've been able to serve in these last few years. I mean, perhaps it's because Maryland is so close to the water, not unlike Louisiana. But for whatever reason, we've been able to accomplish some really meaningful things, whether it was the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative or whether it was passing a climate change bill to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, renewable energy portfolio, the Empower Maryland Initiative to reduce energy consumption. But all of those things were made possible by the awareness of our people. In other words, you can go as far as the awareness of the electorate supports and allows. And if you try to do things in ways that step beyond the will and the awareness of the people, then those will be things that will not last very long. So, like it or not, the truth of the matter is the best form of government that's ever been created on the planet is this democratic representative form of government. It requires leaders to press the envelope and to be willing to speak the difficult truths. And it also requires people of goodwill to forge consensus and to deepen their own awareness about the reality that we share, including the opportunities that we have the ability to seize together. So, Paul, I don't think that any person in executive office ever leaves after 8 years and says, by God, it's perfect now. You know, all I need's one more brushstroke and the masterpiece is complete. But I do believe that in every stage we can deepen our awareness and forge a larger consensus that allows it to happen.
Right. Well, let me go back to you, Tom. I mean, the rate at which climate change is occurring, or the rate at which greenhouse gases are accumulating in the upper atmosphere, is far faster than the rate at which people are understanding the implications and the physics of it. So even though I understand exactly what you're saying in terms of what you can and can't do as a politician, but what is it that we need to do, politician or not, in order to at least get those in alignment?
Well, there are a couple things I'd say about that. One is, I think Americans, two-thirds of Americans understand this problem. That's the polling data. They understand the problem. They pretty much agree on what the solution is. The basic point here is it important enough for American voters to push their elected officials to get something done? And for that to happen, they have to think it's really important, that it's urgent, and that it affects them and their family. And so when you think about big changes in terms of how people view the world, it brings to mind an old saying about going bankrupt. How did you go bankrupt? Two ways, slowly and then all at once. And that's how I believe big changes come in terms of mass understanding, you know, big groups of people coming to a conclusion that something has to be done. There's a long time where you're sowing the seeds and then people decide in a pretty rapid fashion, wow, we're really there. You know, we've had a chance to think about this, and we think you're right. And I think that trusting the American people, trusting the intelligence and knowledge of the American people is what we should be doing, because Americans are smart. And there are always going to be some people who disagree, but the fact of the matter is 317 million Americans are really smart, and they're paying attention. They're paying attention in 2014, and they're drawing their conclusions. And I think this whole democratic educational process of citizens talking to citizens is magic, just the way Martin said. And it's magic, and people are, the group of people is very, very wise.
And it can become, and Paul, it does reach a point where it does become cascading. I mean, a few years ago, no one would have guessed that there would be such a broad consensus on marriage equality or immigration reform. There's a really broad consensus, and it's cascading. And that same awareness can also cascade on the better choices we need to make in order to catch that awareness curve up with the action curve on climate change.
Is there something we can learn from the LGBT community? Because in 2010, that was a wedge issue that people got elected on. And 4 years later, people have their tail between their legs and are slinking away from positions they took 4 years ago. That was an extraordinary thing, probably commencing with Prop 9 in California until this year in the Supreme Court, where it's pretty much a non-issue virtually. Can that happen with climate change?
Oh, I think it is happening. I think it absolutely is happening with climate change. I mean, look, you talk to any audience under 40, you will not find any people that find any comfort in subscribing to denial. It just won't happen. So I think on climate change, it is happening, maybe not as fast as we want to see it happen, and we have to accelerate that. But I do believe we are reaching that same cascading point on climate change that has already been reached on immigration reform and also on marriage equality.
Right.
And let me say one thing, Paul, about what Martin's saying. I really think in the United States now, the idea of being a climate denier, I mean, people don't really want to go back to 11th grade science class. But I think when you're looking at someone who's running to be governor of Maryland, for instance, you don't really want to vote for somebody who you don't think is commonsensical, who doesn't accept basic science. And I think that's actually a trust issue. If people aren't, and we're there. I think we're there in the United States, that you really cannot be a denier of basic science and have people trust you. You have the right to have those feelings, but people don't want you to hold high executive offices.
And that's a big shift. That's a big shift from just 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And 10 years, it's not that long of a period of time.
Right. So, Tom, you've been in business for, I don't know how many years, 30 years, whatever. What was that point in your life where you realized that climate was an extraordinarily important, even a civilizational issue? What was that point where you went from one way of understanding and certainly maybe being sympathetic to climate change and certainly not against it or not being a denier, but that point in your life where you, in a sense, awakened or woke up and it changed your life?
Well, you know, I went to Stanford Business School. I was a private business person for 30 years. And as a private business person, I pretty much felt that the American political system works. You know, people have different opinions, they scream and yell, but when there's a real problem, we get together and solve it. And that's the history of America. For over 200 years, that's what we've done. We've yelled and screamed a lot, but when the time comes, we compromise and get things done. And in 2007, at the beginning of 2007, I went on the board of a great university near my home, which is Stanford University, which I love. And I wanted to think, for Stanford's sake, what are the issues where it can make a real difference in its research, in its advocacy? Where can Stanford play a role the way they have, honestly, in information technology? So I was trying to think about what are the big issues addressing our society where there's a problem. And I started thinking about climate change, and it didn't seem as if the American political system was addressing it in the way that historically we've reached across the aisle and solved problems. And that is really when I felt like this is a problem, it's our generational challenge, and for whatever reason, we as a nation, we as a group of citizens, are having trouble coming to grips together with accepting the problem, looking it in the face and saying, wow, this is a problem where we're gonna show how great we really are. This is the kind of thing we know how to do. And that's really when I decided I want to be one of the people in that big group of people who band together and figure out how to overcome this and how to make it a great success for us.
Was there a defining moment, a person, a speaker, a book? I mean, was there anything that...
This will seem like
absolutely craven. My wife and I were actually driving in and listening to the radio, and we heard Paul Hawken on the radio. It's awful to say in public.
It
and
is.
We were listening, and we thought, wow, he seems quite intelligent, actually.
Now you know. What happened then? I mean, you heard
I changed my mind. Don't worry about that, Paul. I knew I was wrong.
You listened to Bill, but you listened to Bill too, right?
Yeah,
Bill McKibben.
I did. I got a chance to hear some people, and I thought, wow, I've got to spend a lot more time thinking about that and get to the bottom of it, because I honestly did feel, as a business person, you know, the political system here works. Traditionally, our political system has really worked, and I didn't understand why, in this case, we weren't coming to grips with this more effectively.
Right. And for you, Governor, what was that turning point on climate? Was it just a slow percolation, or was there a year? Or again, where is that point? Because I think all of us here understand the basics. I think all of us here do things that, you know, really move us forward with respect to reducing carbon emissions in the best way we can. But for some people here and many people out, there are times in their lives when they understand that this is really the defining issue of the century. And I'm not saying it has been that way for you, but when did it become a defining issue for you as opposed to just another thought?
From the first days of our administration, I mean, three of our 16 strategic goals have been all about energy, including reducing greenhouse gas emissions. But I suppose, you know, some of the happiest days of my childhood I spent on the Eastern Shore, which is very low-lying areas, not unlike some of them around here and near New Orleans, and really beautiful places. And to see firsthand with one's own eyes those places being overcome by sea level rise and islands in the Chesapeake Bay vanishing, I don't know, I think it's impossible to see that evidence and not be motivated and moved to do something about it.
Yeah. So experience.
The experience.
Yeah. For you,
and
Tom,
love
too,
of place.
Tom?
Well, I think, you know, one of the facts about people who are involved in energy issues and climate issues is when you scratch them, there is always a sense of nature. There's always a personal relationship, an emotional bond with the world in a meaningful way. And the fact of the matter is, the only way to think about this issue, and sometimes people put it in scientific terms and sometimes they put it in policy terms, but the fact is this is a human issue. And it's going to, the way that it impacts people, the way it impacts their health, their love for the outdoors, our ability to make this a big economic boom the way you guys are doing, those are the issues that actually touch people. And that's obvious, you know, that's how it touches me too.
Right. So, Governor, what I was saying to you, we were talking earlier in the green room, I was saying that, you know, politics doesn't really think about eras, doesn't really think about civilization, actually. It thinks about very short-term issues comparatively. You are at a sort of crux. You're at a cross point, you know, in your career. You have so many choices ahead of you on January 1st or whenever you term out. I don't know when it is, but soon. What do you want to do for the rest of your life? What do you want to do in these next 20 years? You have identified this amazing issue, and you have all this talent and skills, and you have lots of good friends like Tom Steyer. What do you want to do for the next 20 years?
Well, I want to do what everybody I believe in the Superdome wants to do, and that is to be of the greatest service we can possibly be to others, which with the opportunities and talents that God has given us. So exactly what course that takes, and each of us has to figure that out. You know,
each yeah, of us I'm asking you. I'll talk to them later.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's what I'm trying to figure out, Paul.
You're trying to figure out.
It's I think the Jesuits' word for that is discernment. So I'm on a journey. I'm on a journey of discernment.
Oh God, are you going to say the same thing, Tom?
Let me say this. Yeah. You're talking about short-termism. Let me give you a real short-termism answer. I'm pretty focused on November 4th, 2014
here.
Right now.
Here.
And I feel as if November 5th, I'm going to start thinking it. I'm going to start to discern my future. But through November 4th, my future is very clear, which is I'm going to be trying to work as hard as I possibly can.
Amen.
But no matter what happens then, win or lose, draw, I mean, the world goes on. So
the world is going to go. I mean, I think one thing that's true, Paul, is I think in 2014, and I think before that, but certainly this year, we have built a base in a bunch of states around the United States where this is a first-tier issue. And we've built a base where we have a relationship with a bunch of citizens, a bunch of voters who really care about this and who have, you know, said they care, and they're not going to disappear on November 5th. And the question is going to be, we're going to look at the upshot and say, how do we build on what we've done? We've tried to do in 2014 as to help as much citizen-to-citizen contact as we could. So as many places that we could get citizens to register other citizens, to knock on doors, to clipboard on college campuses, to talk to each other about the importance of voting and why this issue is so important, we've really tried to go back to the 18th century American democracy and say, this is about us talking to each other and trying to discern, in Martin's words, the right path for us. And that is not going to end on November 5th. On November 5th, we're going to look at the results and say, how do we build on that? That's not the end, that's the beginning.
So you're building a base. And Governor, you speak to the cynicism of politics that is much about right now because of the dysfunctionality of the current Congress and the one prior to that. Speak more to me about, and to the audience, about what you believe, because it's very similar to what Tom is saying. It's very different than the idea that somehow it's just totally corrupted and the system no longer works and we can just abandon it and not vote. And I wish you would speak to that.
Yeah, I think as I was listening to Tom, I mean, the word that I hear is the word of connection and reconnection. Alienation is a choice. If we want to, we can be very alienated from one another. We can be alienated from our leaders. We can be alienated from those who don't think as we think or believe as we believe. But the real challenge here is the challenge of connection and reconnection. And understanding our connections not only with one another, but also the other living systems of this planet as we confront this systems engineering challenge here. I think the great hope of our politics right now is actually the hope that comes from rediscovering that 18th century truth that we're actually all in this together, that we need each other, and that we're going to be more successful when we act in life-giving ways together. And I see it. I see us moving forward and not going back. I mean, we're in a race with time, clearly, but we're not going back. I mean, this is an emerging consensus,
right.
And it's one that all of us have the ability to bring forward and to accelerate in our compassion for and with one another.
Bill McKibben once said that when he compared the laws of physics and the laws of Congress, he said he thought the laws of physics would prevail, which is another way of saying that people will come around to what is the law. And the law is thermodynamics and all the other principles that actually create climate change. I mean, they're not going to go away.
And there's a big generational shift. I don't know exactly what's caused it. But there is a generational shift that is happening in our world and certainly in our country that people, younger people, and by that I define as under 40, see that their greater prosperity and security will be achieved through closer connections to one another,
right,
and not from greater separation. And you see this demonstrated in young people's choices to live in cities. You see it in the better ways that cities are being governed. You see this in in many ways. But that is, I think, a very needed shift. Couldn't happen sooner, and there's great hope in that shift.
When we were speaking a couple of weeks ago, you were saying that the pursuit of wealth, this is interesting coming from you, there's probably just a few, two or three people out there who would like to be as wealthy as you. The rest of us don't care, really. And but you said that pursuing wealth for the sake of wealth was risking everything for nothing.
Well, let me put what Paul said into a little bit of context. You know, I've never been driven by money. I mean, it may seem funny for somebody who is a business person for 30 years and an investor. And I've never understood the idea that when you have enough, that your purpose then goes to have as much as possible in a kind of blind competitive pursuit. And really, I think the meaning of life comes a lot more in what Martin's talking about, when you have a much more, you know, complete, integrated view of what you're trying to do in terms of a broader view of life, including your family and your community, and trying to leave the world in a way that you're proud of. And so I think if people lose track of that, it's, you know, we can be so competitive. Humans can be so competitive, and they can be also so wonderful. And I think it's really important for all of us to remember that we're part of a community. We are connected. We have shared interests. We have responsibilities for each other. And taking care of those responsibilities is actually a great joy. And when we forget that, I think we can get turned too much into ourselves. And so when I see people make those decisions where I feel like they've lost the broader purpose in life, I don't really condemn them, but I do feel sorry for them, because I think they're missing the most fun parts of life, the most rewarding parts of life.
Right. Thank you. So without revealing any secrets here, sometimes when I wake up in the morning on the West Coast, I get an email from you that was sent at 2 a.m. or 2:30 a.m. my time, from the East Coast, and it is about some wonderful passage you found in Thomas Berry or Aquinas or others. I guess the question I want to ask you is, how do you integrate this Jesuit side of you with the rough and tumble world of politics, which it is in Baltimore when you're a mayor, very rough and tumble, and it certainly is in Annapolis as governor. How do you bring those together as a person?
I don't know. How do you take them apart?
Whoa.
How do you pull them apart?
Yeah.
I mean, they both go together. My father, I'm going to give you a personal answer and then and kind of the political answer. Okay. here's a personal answer. My father was a very deeply spiritual man. And on occasion, when any of his children would complain about the unfairness of this world, he would say to us, "Son, Christ loved this world, and it crucified him. What makes you expect better?" So that's the personal answer. On the political answer, any of us who I think go into politics and public service for the right reasons do so knowing that there is a range to that service. And some of the things involve cutting ribbons and having everybody applauding when you say nice things about the good things that they've done. And another part of that service, which is also very real, is being willing to put yourself on that fulcrum of the difficult choices and to be criticized or reviled or hated or spat at. And that, too, is service. And on days when you ever want to feel sorry for yourself, anyone in public service needs to tell themselves that they are not in Afghanistan and they are not in Iraq and they have a relatively easy public job.
Yeah. Tom, there's a lot of companies out here, a lot of companies at the conference hall. Is there something you want to say to the business community as a business person?
Well, let me say this. I'm not sure exactly what Paul's driving at, but there is something that I believe about business's role in the United States.
Yeah.
And that is, business is our means of affecting change. And our means of affecting change in terms of clean energy, green building, renewable energy, energy saving, is all going to come from the innovation and the drive of business. And I think that people underestimate the ingenuity and the perspicacity of American business people. I think that if you look industry by industry, you can see the revolutions that happen when American business people are freed up to try new things. And I believe strongly that the way that we're going to solve this problem is by giving the green light, in effect, to business people to go after it as hard as they possibly can. And so when I think about American business, I definitely think of them as the solver of this problem. That is what American business has done in so many industries, and you guys are doing it, and we're going to do it across the economy. But I also think that for it to happen, progressive American business people are going to have to speak up, because this has lots of ramifications in lots of different ways, in terms of health, in terms of the environment, but also very definitely in terms of jobs, in terms of economic growth. And nobody in the United States believes that we can have strong economic growth and a vibrant economy unless business people tell them it's true. So there is a huge role for business people, like the people here, to speak out publicly, to make the case that this is a great opportunity for us to make a bunch of money and to do it in the right way and to have an outcome that's fantastic. So I as a business person, I feel really strongly that there's a dual role here, not just to affect the change, not just to come up with the innovations, but also to speak out and say, it is possible to do it. This is not pie in the sky. This is something we know how to do, and we will do.
That's what I wanted you to say.
Same question?
Yeah. Is there anything you'd like to say that you haven't said, or we have a few moments?
Let me dovetail off of what Tom said. And I truly believe, Paul, that we are the greatest problem-solving people that ever formed a republic in the history of human civilization. And this world really needs us now. And part of that problem-solving also involves that we look at our politics as a tool that can also help us solve this problem. In other words, I guess my plea to everyone here tonight is not to disengage from politics. I mean, politics, we should not look on it as some sort of straitjacket, some sort of form that no longer fits us. It's a canvas. It is a canvas. And each of us has a role to play in the paint that is applied to that canvas and the sort of politics that can also serve a human purpose. It is what we make of it. And I just encourage everyone here as we advance in our innovations and green design and reimagining our world and creating buildings that can do things we could never have imagined a generation before, we also have the courage to imagine that our politics can be different, that our politics can be the politics of compassion and generosity and giving and a better future for our kids.
Thank you. Tom, the last word.
Well, the last word that's on my mind is November 4th. And I think there's no doubt in my mind that in America, I've learned a couple of things not being a business person, but getting involved on the fringes of politics. And one of the things that I've learned is that the opinion of an American doesn't really count at all. But the vote of an American counts a great deal. And unless I have a 94-year-old friend back in California named George Shultz who always says, democracy is not a spectator sport. We are incredibly powerful when we go out and vote. We are incredibly powerful when we go out and volunteer. And we're incredibly powerful when we go and talk to each other. And when we do that, we do really well as a people. And I think it's incumbent on us, if this really is, which I firmly believe, our generational challenge, it's important that we do those basic citizenship obligations, and at the end of it, we're going to feel very good about where we came out.
Great. Thank you both very, very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Grown-ups talk about the end of the world, but I see a world that is beginning. They talk about how climate change is happening to us, but maybe it's happening for us. Maybe it's the transformation that will change everything. What if we know what to do about climate change and are doing it? What if we work together to heal the future instead of stealing it? I see new beginnings everywhere. Because when something is happening, it is possible. Just look around you.
That's Gabrielle Pizzola. She's 11 years old. And when she did this for us, after she did it, she just remarked offhandedly that she's also been in Broadway. What you see on the marquee and what you see on the screens here are a partial list of substantive solutions to climate change. And they're at the very heart of Project Drawdown, which I want to explain and present to you. First of all, what does drawdown mean? Drawdown is the turning point where greenhouse gases decline on a year-to-year basis. And if we're going to change the course of civilization, we have to be very clear about what our goal is. It is not stabilization at 500 ppm, 550 ppm. It's chaos. The goal, and the only goal that makes sense for the world in the 21st century, is drawdown. No other goal can be acceptable. The IPCC has done a magnificent job creating the book of problems with the five assessments. Extraordinary science based on over 2 billion data points. Project Drawdown is a book of solutions. It is co-created by hundreds of scientists, business people, political leaders, students, scholars, civil society, activists, writers, members of parliament, and more. It describes and analyzes 100 substantive state-of-the-shelf technologies and the impact they will have over the next 30 years if they scale robustly and vigorously. Expand as if our pants were at least smoldering, if not pants on fire. And there is a widespread belief, I believe, that climate solutions are either top-down or bottom-up, but in fact, they exist in all areas of human endeavor. And solutions in drawdown include solar, wind, electric cars, all the usual suspects. But there are also 90 other solutions, many that are overlooked, that will have a profound impact on greenhouse gases. Girls' education in the developing world, clean cook stoves, the peer-to-peer economy, dynamic building skins, conductive cooling, walkable cities, pasture cropping, rotational grazing, carbon farming, dirt cheap, printable solar panels, kite sails, and of course, the suite of innovations that are transforming the built environment. Now, let's look at five of the solutions as narrated by a person who understands them well. Along with carbon emissions, we calculate at drawdown the cost of each solution and the net cost or savings over a 30-year timeline. Almost without exception, there is zero net cost. Each provides a significant return on investment. Ladies and gentlemen, Rao Mulpuri, CEO of View.
Windows are essential to our well-being, yet they're the largest contributor to heat loss in a building, causing heating and cooling systems to burn through up to 25% in excess energy in order to provide a comfortable interior environment for us. Windows made with smart glass automatically adjust lighting and shading for user well-being and energy optimization. Smart glass reduces the size and cost of HVAC systems, cooling towers, pumps, plumbings, and motors, entire energy systems. intelligently controlled smart glass is so advanced that sensors and algorithms can optimize each panel of glass in a building to different needs, a dynamic skin that is responding to weather and light in real time. In the United States, highly insulating smart glass windows could save 4.5% of the entire United States energy consumption. By 2045, the implementation of smart glass in new and older buildings could result in global savings of $1.2 trillion and reduction of over 1 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide from our atmosphere.
I'm Janine Benyus from Biomimicry 3.8. Grasslands are the largest ecosystems on the planet, comprising 36% of total land area. When intensively grazed by animals for short periods, grasslands respond. They grow extensive root networks and robust top growth, metabolizing more carbon. Deeper roots store carbon at deeper levels, where it can remain sequestered for centuries. Networks of mycorrhizal fungi exchange water, sugar, nutrients to and from roots, from plant to plant. Plants grown in these mycorrhizal-rich soils will deposit 15 times more carbon than plants grown in sterile, artificial fertilized soils. So if we practice rotational grazing on 1.2 billion acres, which is 10% of all the farms and ranches and pastures, we could sequester a half a ton per acre. And by 2045, we could draw down 64 billion tons of carbon dioxide from our atmosphere. This makes rotational grazing the largest contributor to mitigating global warming.
Hey, Greenbelt, I'm John Picard. We're always in search of the silver bullet, even those of us who know that sustainability is a high mountain with many fronts. In LED lighting, we've come as close as we probably ever will to one technology that will make a transformative impact. LEDs could reduce CO2 parts per million by 2.5 ppm in the next 30 years, ranking it along solar and wind in terms of impact. Consider this, 19% of our global electricity use is consumed by lighting, more than all of the hydroelectric and nuclear plants in the world combined. LEDs can reduce that energy use for lighting by 60% by 2045. Today, the cost of an LED light is 0.1 cent per lumen, down from $100 a lumen nearly 50 years ago when the first LED was sold. Globally, we will save a record $8.3 trillion in energy costs over the next 3 years. People, LEDs will move the needle in this space.
Hello. I'm Maria Carolina Fujihara from the Brazil Green Building Council. As you know, Germany beat us in the World Cup 7-1, from which we are still recovering. However, we beat Germany 12-0 with our 12 LED stadia built for the World Cup. Solar and LED are like rice and beans, peanuts and salt. Enough sun reaches the earth in 1 week to power our current energy needs for 112 years. It's clearly the energy source of the future, growing at an exponential rate. By 2045, it is projected to supply 30% of the world's electricity, but every prediction about the growth has been too low. It could be 40, even 50% of our electrical energy by 2045. Solar power can reduce carbon concentrations in the atmosphere by 46.2 billion tons by 2045, reducing CO2 concentrations by 5.9 parts per million.
Hi, I'm Amanda Ravenhill, the Executive Director of Project Drawdown. Girls' education is one of the most powerful climate solutions that we've found because of its strong impact on curbing population growth, with multiplier effects that last generation after generation. A girl educated through secondary school will be empowered to have, on average, 2 less children in her lifetime. Of course, the benefits don't stop there. Every additional year of primary school boosts girls' eventual wages by 10 to 20%. As fertility rates decline, so does the impact of population on the Earth, as the average person creates 1.3 metric tons of CO2 per year. An investment of $85 billion would provide basic education for the 65 million girls without access to schooling. Over the next 30 years, this investment equates to a reduction of over 8 billion tons of greenhouse gases. Thank you. You're invited to join our coalition. Please join us at drawdown.org.
So let's think about Gabrielle's question again. Is climate change happening to you or for you? Think about it, because if it's happening to you, then you're a victim, you're an object, you're disempowered. But if you embrace it the way Tom mentioned, and as the governor did as well, then it is your ally. When you go into a room and you say climate change, how many people light up and get excited, really, or inspired? It doesn't happen. We have to change that. In order to stop greenhouse gas emissions, there needs to be a change of the climate on the ground. A change in the climate of business, in the climate of politics, in the climate of society. We cannot fight climate change. The idea of fighting is about winners and losers. And that is exactly the thinking that got us into that situation. We have to embrace climate change as our ally and as a guide to a far better world than we know now. And this avoidance of despair is an essential condition in order for humanity to creatively respond to the future we face. The public's willingness to respond to climate change can shift if they see opportunity instead of dread, that a transformation can benefit them individually, collectively, that is not game over, as is so often heard and said, but in fact, it is game on. And just as Gabriel said, maybe, just maybe, the transformation required by climate change marks the beginning of a new world, not the end. When Abraham Lincoln was struggling with the impact of the Emancipation Proclamation, and he was definitely struggling with it, he turned to one of the greatest orators, statesmen, and minds of the 19th century, Frederick Douglass. Born and raised first as a slave, as a freed slave later on the eastern shore of Maryland. In a one-on-one meeting the president requested, Douglass was very, very clear. And what he said is, what we picture, the image we have of the future, will determine our future. And right now, our image of the future is catastrophic. What he was saying to the president is, only through our ideals can we understand, see, and know the real, what is real. It is not the other way around. There are 2 sponsors of Drawdown here tonight, Interface and the USGBC. Ray Anderson is writing checks from heaven, and we are so grateful. Yeah. And USGBC has just been a powerful, extraordinary ally to me and my work for 21 years. Thank you so much, Kimberly, Rick, everybody at USGBC. But we also want to invite any and all of you to join them as supporters. We are not after your balance sheet if you have a company, don't worry. If you are a billion-dollar company and you give us $100, we will be overjoyed, because that means you support this idea, you support this work. And of course we need money, but what we need much more than that is this project, this book, this database, this website, that be created by a broad base of humanity from all sectors of society. People need to know that you, your company, your foundation, your organization supports it and or is a partner. And carbon is not our enemy. It's our ally. Some of it we have to bring home, back to where it belongs. It's up there. But the more we study it, the more amazed we become. And it's not just the basis of life, it is the basis of civilization. And carbon as an element is one that holds hands and collaborates. And this has been the objective of the USGBC since its founding. And this is the objective of Drawdown. Climate change is begging us to dream and not to hide. And the world is asking you to come together and collaborate. Thank you very much. Have a great time tonight.